I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. This is that powerful and wonderful passage of Scripture in Galatians, the second chapter, verses 20 and 21. Now, I love this passage of Scripture. I've read it, reread it. It's marked in my Bible in bold red. This is a powerful passage of Scripture, but you know what? I don't like to talk as much about theology as I do the actual practice of theology. I've heard many people wax eloquent on this passage. I've heard pastor after pastor preach upon this vital scripture. But let's break it down a little bit. Let's talk about it in very practical terms, where the rubber hits the road. I have been crucified with Christ. What's that mean? Well, literally, you're saying, I have been executed with Christ. That's not something that just rolls off my tongue. To be executed is not something pretty. It's not something sentimental. It's not something romantic. To be crucified is to die in the most horrific manner. And if you remember, Jesus said, if you would be my disciple, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And he, of course, was on his way to Golgotha, where he was going to be crucified with every intent that you and I should be crucified with him as well. A death. If you look at Romans, and let's just quickly turn there, Romans, the sixth chapter. This lays it out in very stark, plain terms. What shall we say? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? That's the truth of the gospel. The good news is the bad news. The good news is the bad news. The good news says you're to be crucified. You are to die. There's only one way to escape the penalty of the law, and that is by dying, by giving up your life. Let's be very bold as we speak about this. It means literally to give up my ambition, to give up my dreams, my goals, to give up my money, to give up the right of choosing a wife for myself or a husband for myself, to give up the right of ownership in every respect. A man or woman doesn't come through quickly on this deal. There has to be due consideration given at each step. My reputation, my ambition, my love of money, control of my time, my responsibilities. I have a family. I'm responsible for my family. Are you? Are you? Or have you given your family to Jesus? Well, I'm a steward of my money. No, you're not. Not if you're saved. You're not a steward of God's money, even. You simply do what he tells you to do. There's no judgment on your part about how you're going to function. You get your orders straight from the throne of God. You get your orders from the Holy Spirit. You see, if we're going to really talk about dying, we have to talk about how we're going to live then. It says, Romans, the 6th chapter, verse 3, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. It is that new life that God is after. It's not the old life with an overlay somehow of theology or Christian spray paint. That's not what God has called us to. He's called us to live a new life. And that new life is one in which I have given up control of everything to Jesus, to the Holy Spirit. He's in charge of my life. I'm not in charge anymore. It says, if we've been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be done away with. Literally, in the Greek, that the body of sin is destroyed. It's not just suppressed, it's destroyed. We should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. If you are still walking in any known sin against the Most High God, it's because you haven't yet died. The call of the cross is for every man and every woman to lay down their life, to die, to be born again as a new creature in Christ. So let's go back to this Galatians passage of Scripture. I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The sign that Christ lives in us is that love flows from us. Perfection in the Christian faith is perfection in love. It is a love that flows from our heart for the unloving and the unlovable. It is a love that flows out of us in a self-sacrificing way. We have a dear one who needs financial help. And in our pocket, we have money saved. It means we take that money out and we give it to them because we prefer one another over ourselves. Well, what if giving that money puts me at risk? Isn't that how it's supposed to be? Isn't that what we're called to? To trust in Jesus and to do as he asks us to do in loving other people. The gospel is about being free to love, not in words, but in deeds and in actions. To pour our life out for another, to be given to another. That's the gospel of Jesus. Literally, he's saying, I no longer live. I don't live anymore. Jesus lives in me now. Have you come to that place where you've been willing to lay down your life? See, many said that they were followers of Jesus. And then we find in John the story where Jesus said to them, "My body is real food, and my blood is real drink. Don't work for food that doesn't last. Eat my body. Drink my blood." And many said, "That's a hard saying. We're leaving." Well, those were followers of Jesus who were finally confronted with the reality that it is only those who feast on Jesus, who find all of their nurturance, who find all of their purpose for life, who find all of their answers, they find in Jesus Christ. And he is enough for them. They don't go to hidey caves and drink in from other idols. They don't find themselves resting in front of the television set. They don't find themselves resting in the football or the basketball or the baseball or the soccer. That's not where they rest. They don't rest in the tennis game. They rest in Jesus Christ. See, this is a radical position in America, because Americans, of course, want to be able to have all of their lifestyle of the rich and famous, and they want Jesus too. Not possible. Oxymoron. It doesn't work that way. If we want to talk practically about this passage of Scripture, he says, "The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God." What's it mean, "I live by faith in the Son of God"? It literally means that Jesus becomes your source of food and shelter and companionship. And you don't go out and try to create for yourself. Instead, you listen to the voice of the Spirit and you walk in obedience to his commands in your life. And of course, I can already hear some of you saying to me, "But Pastor, God doesn't speak to me. How am I supposed to know where to go? What to do?" Well, let's be honest. If some of you today were to take the position that I will only receive from the hand of Jesus what he gives me, you would soon starve to death, because Jesus is not going to give you anything. Why? Because you have not met the conditions necessary for Jesus to begin to take responsibility for feeding you and sheltering you and providing for you. Why? Because you're walking in disobedience before the Lord, and you're still walking in the ownership of your life. You're still in charge of your life, and you want Jesus to now come and give to you what you want and what you think you need, but you don't belong to Jesus yet. So, Romans, the 12th chapter, Romans 12:1, "Therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices," or could I say, living martyrs, "holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship," the only spiritual life that God is interested in. Now, you can be a Buddhist and be very spiritual. You can be a Hindu and be very spiritual. You can be a Muslim and be very spiritual. You can be a whatever and be very spiritual. And people say to me, "I'm a very spiritual person, but I'm not a part of church. I'm really not a Christian. I think everybody has to find their own path. I'm a very spiritual person." That kind of spirituality is not pleasing to God. The only kind of spirituality that he is interested in is where you lay your life down on that altar of burnt offering. You remember in the Old Covenant, in the tabernacle, there was the entrance to the meeting place, to the courtyard. And as you enter into that opening, your back is to the sun or to the Baal god. So the first step in the Old Covenant to coming into the presence of God is you turn your back on prosperity that comes from Baal. Now, God will bring prosperity as he chooses for the sake of his kingdom. But we turn our back on the human way of Baal worship, the god of prosperity. And there we find an animal. And the man lays his head on the head of that animal. He lays his hand on that animal and cuts its throat, and the blood flows. And that animal is then prepared and offered as a burnt offering before God. Then beyond that altar burnt offering, you come to the laver, and that's the place where the priest would wash. All the blood is washed, the filth is washed. And then they go into the holy compartment, and on the right-hand side is the table of showbread, symbolizing a person who has given up their life. They are now the food of God. And on the left-hand side is that beautiful candelabra representing the light that flows from the Holy Spirit. And right ahead of them is that altar of burnt incense where the prayers ascend before the throne of God. And then the veil between the holy and the most holy that the new covenant tells us is a representation of Jesus Christ. That veil was rent at Calvary, and now we enter in to the most holy compartment where the Ark of the Covenant is, where the Shekinah glory of God is. But you see, none of this is possible until you have come to that altar of burnt offering. And the Apostle Paul is saying to us, look, if you want to even begin this journey toward heaven, if you want to begin this journey toward knowing Jesus Christ, the first step in this journey is that you lay your life down. As he said in Colossians, or in Galatians, you're going to have to be crucified. In other words, you lay your life down as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. The only spiritual act of worship that God will honor is when you come before him and you lay your life down on that altar of burnt offering as a living sacrifice in service to Jesus Christ. That's the only way in. Then do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. In other words, you have died. You are now no longer going to act like, talk like, walk like. You're not going to look like the world. You will look instead like Jesus Christ, because again, according to Galatians, he comes and lives in us. It says, but be transformed by the renewing, or the word literally in the Greek, renovation, where everything is stripped out. The walls are taken out, the floors picked up, everything is stripped out, and it is renovated. It is made new. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So there's no way that you can begin to know the will of God and feast on the body of Jesus and drink his blood until you have laid your life down. That's the call. Lay your life down. And we go back to this Galatians passage. It says, the life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. If righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. See, righteousness is only given as a gift through Jesus Christ when we've laid our life down. And when we lay our life down, then we have the power of the Holy Spirit that begins to flow in us. I want to take us now to the story of Rees Howells. It's from the book Rees Howells' Intercessor, written by Norman Grubb. My name is Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. I'm glad you're with us today, and I pray that your heart will be stirred by what I'm going to share with you today. Rees Howells has just gone through a confrontation with the Holy Spirit, where the Lord has offered him a place to sit in the heavenly realms. And he has finally allowed the Holy Spirit to finish this work in his heart of being crucified with Christ. And the first place that things began to change then were in his prayer life. I'll read for you his words. The meaning of prayer is an answer. And all that I give you, see that you lose nothing. The Lord also told him that effectual praying must be guided praying, and that he was no longer to pray for all kinds of things at his own whim or fancy, but only the prayers the Holy Ghost gave him to pray. We often weary God with prayers, foolish prayers. I find myself more and more as I've grown in Christ, asking him, what would you have me pray? What could I come in agreement with you today, Jesus? I know those prayers will be answered quickly. Coupled with this was another important lesson that he was never again to ask God to answer a prayer through others if he could answer it through Rees. That included his money. When there was a prayer for money, he must allow his own money to be used, because now it belonged to Jesus. The Holy Spirit showed him that in the unsurrendered state, he could spend time in asking God to supply the foreign fields and other causes, and yet not be willing for God to answer the prayer through him, and that often the Lord is wearied with our words. So he has one outstanding answer to prayer in Will Battery, a homeless man that he just began to pour out his love for and his resources to win this man to Jesus, and that finally took place. The second outstanding prayer that the Holy Spirit prayed through him was for a man who went by the name of Jim Stakes. It was also the means by which the Holy Spirit gave Rees Howells his first lesson in princely giving. As he said later, since my money now belongs to the new tenant, the old tenant has to be impartial about the amount he gives. The new tenant, by his nature, is more generous than the old one. The latter has lived so long in Egypt and later in the wilderness under the law that he has only been used at best to give the tithe. So when the new tenant wants to be able to give a princely gift, the first test is the reality of the surrender. If it is proved genuine, then there will be no future conflicts when large amounts are called for. The test for Rees was on Jim Stakes. This man had been such a low character that the common saying was, what Jim Stakes would not do, the devil himself could not do. He was one of the worst drunkards, and there was a great sensation during the revival when he went under conviction and then came out for salvation in a prayer meeting. He had a house full of children, and through his old drinking habit, he was in great poverty. Rees Howells had only met him once, but knew him well by reputation. One morning, when in prayer, quite unexpectedly, Rees saw this man standing before him. I'd never before known such a conflict for a soul in the spiritual realm, Reese said. For an hour, it was as much as I could do to allow the Holy Spirit to pray through me. I saw the devil attacking him, and that if he could get him to back it, it would be one of the worst things that could happen for the work of the revival. I saw that it was a conflict between God and the devil for a soul, and I told the Lord I would do anything if he would keep a hold of Jim Stakes. That very evening, there was a man at the door to see him. Reese never had a greater surprise. It was Jim Stakes. He'd come a distance of 2 miles because he said that while he was working in the mine that morning, at 10 o'clock, Reese Howells had stood before him. It was at that very hour in the morning that Jim Stakes had stood before Reese, and the burden of prayer had come upon him. "Are you in trouble?" Reese asked him. He was indeed. He was 2 years behind in his rent, and that morning the bailiff had marked his furniture and had come and was coming to take it. 2 years' rent. That was a lot of money. After a moment's hesitation, Reese Howell said, "I'll give you 1 year's rent, and I have a friend who I believe will give you the other half." He went upstairs to get the money, but before he could reach the top of the stairs, the Holy Spirit spoke to him. "Didn't you tell me this morning that you would give all you had to save him? Why are you giving him only half? Did not the Savior pay all your debt and set you free?" Reese Howells turned and ran down the stairs and said to the man, "I am sorry. I told you I would give only 1 year's rent. I am to give you 2 years' rent and all that you need besides. I am, pardon me, I am to deliver you in such a way that the devil can't use this situation any longer to get at you." "The moment I said that," Mr. Howells declared later, "the joy of heaven came down. It was as if something snapped in my nature, and it became more blessed to give than to receive. The amount of the gift, £70. Mr. Howells took him straight over that evening to see a friend and have prayer together, and on the way he asked him if his wife was converted. Hadn't she seen a change in him, and wasn't she glad? "Yes," Jim replied, "but she's not saved, and she hasn't had the clothes to go to meeting." As he listened, Reese Howells said he felt the Spirit as though virtue had gone out to her, and he knew that she too would be converted. The following Sunday, he went to their house and found her under conviction. The princely gift had broken her down. Love had conquered. And the Holy Spirit led her to the foot of the cross, where she saw that a still greater debt had been paid for her, and paid with a greater price, the precious blood of Christ Jesus. The blessing of this couple was what Reese called the beginning of days in the district, because cottage meetings were started in their home every Saturday and Sunday evening, led by Reese Howells and his friends. Many came to them, and some of the worst characters gave their hearts to the Lord. In this new experience of life in the Holy Ghost, Reese had one whose fellowship meant much to him, his Uncle Dick. When Reese had returned from the convention, not all believers, by any means, could see the need of a total surrender to the Holy Spirit. Some even opposed the idea. But God gave him one of like mind and heart in his uncle. Of all the believers in the district, it might have been thought that Uncle Dick had least need of this full surrender. For 26 years, he had been an invalid and not able to walk more than a few yards, nor to read to himself more than a few minutes at a time. He had accepted this condition as the will of God and spent hours daily in prayer or having the Bible read to him by members of the family. Before the revival, when the spiritual state of the country had been so low, he had joined with many in praying for a quickening and had greatly rejoiced when the answer came. Yet he also knew his own need. Before the revival, even among the most godly in the church, few had known of eternal life as a free gift or of an assurance of forgiveness of sins. Even after the revival, the truth of the Holy Spirit as a divine person living in a believer's body was hidden from most, including Uncle Dick. He had a longing for more power in prayer, but he'd never known how to get it. Uncle Dick rejoiced in Reese's conversion, and it was to him that Reese continued to look up to as his most valued spiritual guide. Naturally, he would be the first to whom Reese would go on his return to tell of his new experience. But the visit was not an easy one because the Lord had revealed to Reese that he was to offer the Holy Spirit to his uncle. And where the younger had been accustomed to being blessed through the elder, the reverse was now to be the case. But Uncle Dick was ready. As Reese told him of the blessing and the price of complete surrender of the will with no reserve, his uncle recognized it as the word of the Lord and the truth of the Scriptures. It took him 3 weeks to settle the matter. Each visit Reese made, his uncle would say, "I am sure I will be through in a few days." And when he did come through, it was a glorious victory. It was an illustration of the fact that a man may be godly and devoted, yet still need the Holy Ghost, and find it by no means easy to make a full surrender. I need to stop there. I very seldom in the church today see any glorious victory in God's people. The reason I don't see any glorious victory is because for the most part, we have completely lost the notion that a man or woman must make a complete and full surrender to Jesus Christ. We have substituted that for an acknowledgement that Jesus is Lord and Savior. We have substituted this with much teaching on the Scriptures, but also great worldliness has come into the church. And so most pastors have not made a full surrender to Jesus. And I find that a congregation cannot go higher than their pastor goes. A pastor can preach eloquent, wonderful educational sermons, inspirational sermons. He can use multimedia. They can be very entertaining. Often pastors open their sermon with a joke, and the congregation laughs with them. But there is a part missing. Most pastors have not made a full surrender to Jesus yet. They have not given up their lives. They have not yet been crucified with Christ. And so we have all manner of foolish teaching, teaching that says you can be saved in the midst of your sin, national broadcasters teaching that you can be saved and still walk in sin, teaching that there is a limited atonement and that only a few people can be saved, that you cannot repent without the gift of God, and so those who can't repent will go to hell because God didn't give them the gift of repentance. All of these things are lies. There is an unlimited atonement. All men have been commanded to repent, and God does not command all men to repent without giving them the ability to repent. But these lies have filled the hearts and minds of people. And then churches that came out of holiness backgrounds like a Nazarene church that I know of, one of their key leaders has said to me, "Pastor, you don't understand the gospel. The gospel of Jesus coming from a Nazarene church, the gospel of Jesus is that I am saved as a gift of grace, and I'll never overcome my sin. And there is no second touch." We've dropped that whole notion of a second touch where even the old sinful nature is put away and the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit comes. We've put all of that away. Is it any wonder that paganism is growing by leaps and bounds? That Wicca, witchcraft, is the fastest growing religion in America? It's astounding to me. We have given up the one sole element that will change a man or woman's life and give them victory. We have denied the blood of Jesus Christ. We have denied that it has the power to transform a man or woman's life. We've denied this. Uncle Dick, in this story, lived a righteous life, but he recognized he was still lacking. He could force outward compliance. He could love the Lord, but he still hadn't gone fully to the cross. After this glorious victory of full surrender, from that time onward and for many years, the fellowship and the spirit between uncle and nephew was very deep. It was a spiritual partnership in which Uncle Dick became Reese's chief prayer partner. He continued his prayer work for some 8 hours a day. Now that's an interesting retirement, isn't it? Retire and spend all day, full work days, in the prayer closet. This is what it's going to take. I listen to pastors who've retired and they say to me, "Pastor Ray, aren't you going to retire? Are you kidding me? I'll not ever retire until I'm on the other side, and then I'll be there to do God's bidding. I don't expect to ever retire. If my health were to break and I could not pastor, I would not retire. I would spend all of my time in the prayer closet interceding for the work of God. There's no such thing as retirement for a pastor. And frankly, for a Christian, there's no such thing as retirement. There's only the transition where God releases you from the work in the mind so you can spend full time now working in the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's not retirement. That's not going off to play golf every day. He continued his prayer work for some 8 hours a day, but with this difference: up to that time, when the Holy Ghost took full possession, any need that arose automatically became a subject of prayer. But from henceforth, as with Reese, it was guided praying with specific objectives, victorious travail, and definite answers. My name is Ray Greenlee. You're listening to Pilgrim's Progress, and our phone number is 877-534-0780. And some of you have also asked me for a mailing address for the National Prayer Chapel. So let me give you a mailing address. Some of you have said, "Please, Pastor, we want to send a contribution, and we don't know where to send it." And some of you have said, "Pastor, is there a way we can use a credit card?" No, we will never take credit cards for the work of God. Come on, get real. If you'd like to have our mailing address, if you'd like to write to me, you're welcome to do that. It's National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia. Again, it's the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, And the zip code is 22195. I'd love to hear from some of you. It's the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Our services are held on Tuesday evening at 7:30 and also on Sunday afternoon at 12:30 at the All Saints Anglican Church, located at 14851 Gideon Drive. That's 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia. I want to share with you now the next step for Reese Howells. About a half a mile from Jim Stake's home, there was a village without even a single Christian or a single place of worship. At the time of the revival, people had started prayer meetings in the village, but they soon fell apart. After Jim Stakes and his wife had been so blessed, the Lord one day said to Mr. Howells, "As you had such joy in helping those two, wouldn't you like to help a whole village? But in going there, I have another lesson to teach you. You must be the first to suffer." This meant that he must be like a father who is the first to suffer in his family, or a good shepherd who will lay down his life for his sheep. The Spirit showed him that the Savior took the sinner's place as sin bearer, as sickness bearer, and burden bearer. And then going to the village, he was to allow the Spirit to reveal the love of the Savior through him in practical ways. These people had had the best preaching in the revival, and it had not touched any of them. But the Holy Spirit was taking his servant there to be the first sufferer, and everyone who was in need would have a claim on him to supply that need. So one Sunday evening, Reese Howells and his friends, Christian workers, joined him, and they visited the village. Never before had they seen such a sight. Barrels of beer were placed out in the open, and the people were drinking and gambling and playing all kinds of games. The place had been well named Hellfire Row. But as Reese Howells said afterwards, "I had only one thought, that the Holy Ghost was going there and he had authority to cast out devils and forgive sins." And so it proved in the first home he visited. The woman of the house was unwilling to disclose to her visitors that she was baking bread on Sunday, so she allowed it to get burnt in the oven. When Mr. Howells heard of this, he went back to that home and told her he had come to pay for the damage that he had done to her bread, and placed a sovereign coin on her table. A good deed has wings, and very soon the villagers learned that this band of young people, all who worked themselves in the coal mine pit or the shop, were coming with something more than words. The woman opened her cottage for meetings, and she and her husband, who had both been drunkards, were the first to be converted. The woman particularly continuing as one of the best in the village. The Spirit made it plain to Reese Howells that he was to live out the Bible to the people. As their clothes were different from his, he was to dress more plainly so as to attract no attention to himself. He had brought a gold watch back from America, as well as giving one to each of his brothers and sisters, but he was not to wear his again. "If you are the first sufferer, don't have a thing these people can't have," the Lord said to him. Nearly everyone in the village was in need, and the Spirit reminded him of the Sermon on the Mount, "Give to him that asketh thee." "Whoever is in need has a claim on you," he said. "You have given me all you have, and I tell you that it is all for the people, and they have as much right to it as you have." The greatest break came when the Lord laid hold of the ringleader among the drunkards. For a long time, Mr. Howells prayed for him and asked for a chance to get at him. This man could see the love of God expressed toward others, but he had not yet experienced it himself. The opportunity came. There was some trouble outside the village. This man was involved, and it became a court case. The Lord then said to Reese Howells, "Now is your chance. Offer to settle the case for him." So he called at the man's house and asked him, "Would you be relieved if this case could be settled out of court? If the other people are willing to accept compensation, would you like me to pay it for you?" The man was speechless. He was every inch a man. Mere words could never reach him. But when he saw the love of God like that, he was touched on a vital spot and broke down. He confessed that he had been the one at blame, that he had started the issue. He then began to come to the meetings, and his love for one could be felt. It wasn't long before over a dozen were converted. Regular meetings were started, including a Sunday school and a Band of Hope. So many left the public houses and turned to the Lord that the band of workers felt they must give all their time to be with them. They had 5 weeks, 5 meetings a week, and spent the other evenings visiting in the homes. The work of the Spirit spread far beyond this village. Soon there were converts scattered through all the neighborhood. There was such power in the ministry that it used to be said, if Reese Howells visits a home, you watch. Someone will be converted there. Mr. Howells was earning his weekly wage in the mine and also some other savings, but at this rate he saw that his money would soon be finished. It was then that the Spirit allowed him both a commandment and a promise. To the rich young man, the Savior had given the command, "Sell all that thou hast and distribute it to the poor, and come and follow me." And to those who did so follow, he had promised, "There is no man that hath left house or brethren lands for my sake and the gospel's, but he shall receive 100-fold now in this time." Reese saw that if he gave 1 pound, the Savior said he was to get 100 pounds. Could this be true? If it was, he would surely look forward to the day when he could come to his extremity. But was it true? That's what captured his imagination, not the fact of being without money, but the possibility of it being replaced through the promises. Could the exchange really take place and he get the 100-fold? The day came when he reached his last pound. The Holy Spirit then told him, "Cut the ropes and take the promises." It was a direct call to step out on God. But it's always easier to talk of such a thing than to actually do them. It had been much easier to give 100 pounds out of plenty than to part with this last pound and come to the end of his savings for the first time in 15 years. "Oh, how the devil pitied me and brought such arguments," he said. "He told me it would be a step in the dark, and that if there was a convention or anything of that kind, I wouldn't be able to go unless I had 1 pound laid by. But the Holy Spirit showed me that if God wanted me to go anywhere, he would surely provide the means. The danger was on the other side, for if a person has money, he can go without consulting God. Like Jonah, who could afford to pay his passage and run away from God. The fact is, we can never really be bondservants until God does control our money." So Reese took the plunge and learned the blessed truth that his extremity was indeed God's opportunity. His eyes were opened to the fact that he had a claim on God for what he could not supply himself. Just as surely as the Spirit had told him that the people of the village had a claim on his money to meet their needs, so now he saw that he had a claim on God's resources to meet his needs. The first week his need was for 2 pounds, and he was able to tell the Lord in his prayer that he would not have him, that he would not have come to him if he had had it himself. I was only asking the Lord to do what I would have done if I had had the money, and it was his work. It came. And what joy I had in finding that I had finished with the limited resources of man and begun on the unlimited resources of God. The promise of God had replaced money in the bank. The promises of God had replaced money in the bank and became equal to current coin to me. Again, let me read that to you. The promises of God had replaced money in the bank and became equal to current coin to me. I no longer had to carry my treasure with me wherever I went because I knew where the treasury was and how to reach it. I have come to that same place. We're talking about and praying about at the National Prayer Chapel, transitioning from AM to the FM side of the dial. There is an opening, and we've been invited to take it, but it will be at a great increase in cost. The decision about whether or not we should make that transition will not be a decision based on money. It rather is a decision based strictly on the command of God, because we know where the treasury is. We know that if we walk according to the Spirit and in obedience to the Spirit, if we are living martyrs, totally crucified with Christ, then He will supply our need, and we trust Him. In some ways, it's much easier to walk without money because then you simply pray and God gives a decision. You hear what God's direction is, you stand by faith, and He supplies the need. Today, have you been totally given over to Jesus Christ? Have you been filled with the Holy Spirit? Are you one with Christ? Are you crucified with Christ? I'm Pastor Ray Greenlee from the National Prayer Chapel. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon. Great joy. Now unto Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory.